Hello students, I hope you're good and doing your studies very well. So this video is in continuation with the previous one. In the previous video, I started chapter number 4, the plaint of the camel. There you studied the kind of complaints that the camel was making every time and for everything that he had or that he possessed, like the kind of food that he was given to eat. He didn't like it all, and what he actually complained that other animals have different things to eat, and they have their specific and they have their special things to eat. But when it comes to my food, there's no specific thing. I am just given anything to eat, and nobody even bothers about my digestion. Then he made complaints regarding the kind of shelter that he was provided. Actually, no. So what he said that every other animal has something special places, like you also learn, like this animal has the name of the home of this animal is this or this animal is that. But when it comes to the home of the camel, it's like wherever it finds sand. So there was lots and lots of complaints that he was making constantly. That's what we studied in the last video. Then we covered reference to context, and then we did fill in the blanks. I hope you all remember that, whatever we have done so far. Now, we are going to complete the chapter, and that's the main purpose for coming again in this video. So now, without taking your time, let's get started. So here's the link where you can click and go to the SVV webpage. This we did, the plaint of the camel, means all the complaints of the camel. We studied this. Everything we've covered. Reference to context, two references we did. Fill in the blanks. Yes. Now we have to start from here. Match the animals with their surroundings. Surrounding means where they live in. First is lambs. So, if you remember, in the poem we studied, lambs are enclosed where it's never exposed. Means lambs live in an enclosed area. So, you will match lambs with enclosed area. Oysters, they slumber, they sleep in pails. So, oysters, pails. Lizards, lizards live in a creek. So, lizards in a creek. Snake, they live in the ground. So, snake in the ground. Pigs, they live in pens. So, pigs, pens. Camels, they live in the sandy deserts. Sandy deserts. So, how you will write? You will first write all the questions. Then you will put a blank here or make an arrow. And then before every word, before every and the name of the animal, you will write their respective homes. Fill in the blanks with rhyming words of the underlined words from the poem. Okay, so all words which are underlined here, they are, you have to write the rhyming words for them. Rhyming means which sounds similar with them. The lettuce added, lettuce is a kind of vegetable. So the lettuce added a blank line to my sandwich at lunch. Do you remember what was the word? Which here actually synchronizes or which rhymes with lunch? Anybody? I hope you remember the second line of the poem. Parrots have crackers to crunch. So don't you think crunch rhymes with lunch? So you will write here crunch. The lettuce added a crunch to my sandwich at lunch. Second, the poodles love to eat. Easy one, noodles. Third, she frowned on seeing her ring roll on the frowned. It rhymes with ground. You know, you remember snakes live in the ground. Fourth, she was grumpy because the mashed potatoes were still. So grumpy, I think there are three words which rhyme with this word grumpy. Humpy, bumpy and lumpy. All these three words have been used to describe a camel in this poem. So you can write any of them. So let's write lumpy. Okay. Fifth, द हॉर्स वॉज एबल टू स्लीप इन इट्स स्टेबल. सो एबल वुड राइम विद स्टेबल. सो वी विल राइट योर स्टेबल. सिक्स, द कैट्स टेल पीप्ड आउट ऑफ द टेल राइम्स विद टेल. रिमेंबर. Okay, now I think I should ask you, what was the name of the animal which we talked about that it used to that it lives in the pail? Oysters. Okay, so done. Here you will write lunch with lunch. What rhymes? Crunch, poodles, noodles, frowned, ground, grumpy, lumpy, able, stable, tail, pail. Add the prefixes to these words to make new words. Prefixes, as this topic also has already been taught to you. Prefixes is a group of letters which we add at the beginning of the word, and then it forms a new word which has completely different meaning. Complete, incomplete. So we will add I an and it will become a new word, incomplete. Approve, disapprove. D-I-S we will add here. Possible, impossible. Appear, disappear. Built, rebuilt. Known, unknown. Proper, improper. Connect, reconnect. Collect, recollect. Common, uncommon. Okay, so whatever word fits here, you have to write here so that it forms a meaning. So I repeat once again, incomplete, disapprove, impossible, I am, impossible, disappear, rebuilt, unknown, improper, I am, improper, reconnect, recollect, uncommon. Color the abstract nouns. Children, abstract nouns are the nouns which you cannot touch, which you cannot see, which you cannot hear. It is a noun which can only be sensed, like honesty. Honesty is a quality of a person. So whatever quality a person has, you can't touch that quality. You can only sense that quality. If somebody is being sweet to you, that sweet, can you touch that sweetness from in a person? No. You can just sense, you can just feel it. So what we will do here, we will see what are the abstract nouns given in this matrix. Friend. Can you touch a friend? Yes. So is it an abstract noun? Definitely not. Fear. Can you touch fear? No. It is again a state of a person where a person feels very frightened. So it's a state which you cannot touch. So fear is an abstract noun. Friendship. You can touch friend, but can you touch friendship? The relationship, the bond that you share with your friend? Definitely not. So friendship is an abstract noun. Beauty. Of course not. Can you touch beauty of a person? No, you can only feel it. So beauty is again an abstract noun. Bravery? No, you can touch a brave person, but you can't touch the bravery present in that person. So bravery is an abstract noun. Team? Of course you can touch a team. Loyalty? Loyalty means honesty. No, you can't touch honesty or loyalty of a person. So it is an abstract noun. Determination? Of course, one who decides to do something. Can you touch that decision, that determination that the person has? Definitely not. So determination is again an abstract noun. Bunny. Bunny is basically the child of a rabbit. So can you touch it? Of course, you can touch rabbit as well as its kids. So bunny is not an abstract noun. Honesty. Of course, it's an abstract noun. House. You can touch a house, so it cannot be an abstract noun. Freedom? No, you cannot touch freedom. So freedom is an abstract noun. Leader? Yes, you can see, you can touch a leader. So leader is not an abstract noun. Baby? You can touch, right? So baby is again not an abstract noun. Faith? Can you touch faith or belief? No, so this is an abstract noun. Cook? Yes, definitely you can touch the person who cooks. I'll just tell you what are the abstract noun here. So you have to color that. In the first row, fear, friendship, beauty. These three are abstract nouns. In the second row, bravery, loyalty, determination. These three are abstract nouns. In the third row, honesty and freedom are the abstract nouns. While in the fourth row, there is only one abstract noun present, which is faith. I hope you've understood this point. Complete these blanks with the correct or collective nouns. So what is a collective noun? As the name itself suggests, collection of something. And you already know what is noun. Noun is the name of a person, place, animal or thing. So the collection of persons, the collection of places, whatever you call it, they become collective noun. Here I will tell you what we call the collection of hens, soldiers, sailors and so on. First is a blank line of hens. So what do we call a collection of hens? We call brood. We call brood. Second, a blank line of soldiers. So what do we call a collection of soldiers? We call troop. Troop. A troop of soldiers. Third, a blank line of sailors. What do we call? Crew. Crew. A crew of sailors. Fourth, a blank line of dancers. What do we call a collection of dancers? We call troop. Fifth, a blank line of ladies. What do we call a collection of ladies? Bevy. Sixth, a blank line of singers. What do we call? Choir. Seventh, a blank line of gypsies. What do we call? Caravan. Eighth, collection of arrows, what do we call? Quiver. Now for your convenience, I have written down all the answers here. In the next slide, you can pause the video and copy down all the answers. And you have to learn also a brood of hens, a troop of soldiers, a crew of sailors, a troop of dancers, a bevy of ladies, a choir of singers, a caravan of gypsies, a quiver of arrows. I hope this is clear. Now we come to hard words. So there are 11 hard words which I have taken from this poem. One by one, I will tell you every hard word. First is canary. Canary, C-A-N-A-R-Y. Canary, you remember what is it? It's a bird. Canary. Second is poodles. Poodles, P-O-O-D-L-E-S. Poodle means it's a kind of dog breed. Third is digestion. D-I-G-E-S-T-I-O-N, digestion. Fourth is repose. Repose, R-E-P-O-S-E. Repose means rest or sit. You know who was actually reposing? You remember? Cat. Yes, it was a cat who was reposing in a chair. Fifth is roost. Roost, R-O-O-S-T. Roost again means to take rest. Sixth is oysters. Oysters. O-Y-S-T-E-R-S. Oysters. Seventh is slumber. Slumber. S-L-U-M-B-E-R. Slumber means sleep. Eighth is exposed. Exposed. E-X-P-O-S-E-D. Exposed means to come in sight of everyone. Ninth is constructed. Constructed. C-O-N-S-T-R-U-C. T-E-D. Tenth is bestraddle. Bestraddle. B-E-S-T-R-A-D-D-L-E. 11th is sleek. Sleek. S-L-E-E-K. Sleek means smooth. Next, word meanings. First word is plaint. All you already know. Plaint means complaint. I think it's easy to remember also. Second is repose. Repose means relax. With this activity was being performed by the cats. Third is roost. Roost means rest. It was being done by the chickens. Fourth is slumber. Slumber means sleep. So oysters were actually slumbering in pails. Fifth is enclosed. Enclosed means confined. You remember lambs love to live in an enclosed area. Sixth is constructed. Constructed means made. Seventh is mounted. Mounted means climbed. Eighth is bestraddle. Bestraddle means to sit with one's legs on either side of something. The way you sit on bike, you remember you keep your legs on either side of the bike, on both the sides. Remember? Or are you able to understand what I'm trying to convey? De straddle. Ninth is sleek. Sleek means soft or smooth. So there are only 9 word meanings you have to write down in your notebook and you have to learn them. Answer these questions. So these are the 5 questions which are given in your textbook. First, I have just written all the questions so that you can answer first of all on your own. Then I have written answers where you can match from. First is, who is complaining in the poem and why? Second is, how does the camel describe itself in the poem? Why? Third is, where does the camel live? Fourth is, what does the camel say about the homes of other animals? Fifth is, what complaint does the camel have regarding the load it carries? I hope you've written down the answers. Next. So here I have written answers. The first question that you saw was, who is complaining in the poem and why? I think it's the easiest question in the whole chapter. Who is complaining in the poem? The camel. Yes, the camel is complaining in the poem because it feels that other animals are more privileged than him in terms of looks, food and work. Other animals have their specific looks. They have been given special foods to eat. But when it comes to me, nobody bothers about my digestion. Second, how does the camel describe itself in the poem? Why? Do you remember? How did he describe itself? The camel describes itself as lumpy, bumpy and humpy in the poem. It compares itself with other animals who are better in looks as compared to it. It does so because it is unhappy about the way it looks. That's why it was complaining, because it didn't like its look. It was like, I am just lumpy, mumpy and humpy. No specific size, no specific shape is there to which can describe me. Where does a camel live? Of course, a camel lives in sandy deserts. What does the camel say about the homes of other animals? So basically, you have to write the homes of others of other animals which have been mentioned in the poem. The camel says that other animals have special homes especially constructed for them. They make themselves comfortable and relax in their homes while he is left to live in the sandy deserts. So actually what the camel is complaining that every other animal has something special place to live in. But when it comes to my home, I've been left to live in the sandy desert. There is no specific place constructed for me. What complaint does the camel have regarding the load it carries? The camel complains that no one does the riding on the back of an ox, a rabbit or a fox, while families mount themselves on his back. So here the camel is complaining that you already know that nobody actually does the riding of on an ox, or probably you've not seen anybody, most probably you've not seen anybody sitting on a rabbit, neither on fox or nor on any other animal. But when it comes to camels riding, even families mount, mean number of people sits on the back of camel. Okay, so here your chapter is complete. In the last video, I taught you the poem, and in this video, I have covered all the exercises which we could not do in the last video. I think this chapter is clear to you, and it was a lot more fun reading this chapter. So I enjoyed it in person very much, and I hope that you also enjoyed it. Now listen to your work, to your homework carefully. You have to write down all these things in the notebook that you have made for English. You will write hard words, question answers, word meanings, and of course the exercises also. Okay? And then after writing everything in your notebook, you have to learn it by your heart. And then that's where actually your study stops on this chapter. Okay? So yes, that's it. That's enough for us for chapter number 4. We'll try to meet again. Bye.